I'm going to be very direct with you this morning. I'm not going to sneak in the back door, try to manipulate you, catch you off guard, and then spring something on you. This Sunday is about Together in Mission. It was announced before, and we do it every year. And I'll come back to it, okay? When I was in the seminary, they taught us there were basically four types of homilies, sermons. One was to clarify an understanding of faith, to use the Word of God to understand perhaps love or kindness or compassion. Then there was one that was supposed to lead us, the preacher was trying to lead the people to a place of gratitude, just gratitude. And the Word of God is filled with that. There was another kind that was supposed to lead us to a place of praise, especially some of the big feast days. But the more common one was that it answered the question, what could we do or what should we do as Christians, followers of Jesus? So today is a what could we do, what should we do? We have a history. I don't know if you know this, but in the beginning of the formation of this country, the Catholic Church, there was a tremendous prejudice against us. We only had one diocese, Baltimore. That's, remember, the Baltimore Catechism. It came out of there. And people didn't like Catholics. They didn't trust them. Jews also. How long did it take for us to get a president? JFK. JFK. And even then, I remember as a kid that people were saying, is he going to listen to the Pope in Rome or to the Constitution? How can we trust a Catholic? There was a lot of hatred toward Catholics. I remember when I was in Wilmington, there was a big signboard there. I couldn't believe it. But a church, or at least members of this church, paid for a sign. And I saw it in more than this place. It was Pope John Paul II, and he had his hands like this, like he was looking through glasses. And then it said this, Catholic Church - Whore of Babylon. That was the sign, Whore of Babylon. Wow, that was prejudice to the max. But I'll tell you what the Catholic Church did in this country. It came here and formed in order to help fellow Catholics. Not that it wouldn't help others, but primarily to help Catholics, to lift them out of poverty, to get them into the middle class, to get them educated. So one of the things the Catholic Church did here, as it did all over the world, formed schools everywhere, all the way up to university, so that people could be well-rooted in their faith and be very well-educated. It also came building hospitals. And nuns, sisters from all over the world came here to teach and to be nurses. They understood that others weren't going to do it for us. We had to do it for ourselves. So the Catholic Church was there to help and to build. In this parish, they had an Italian Catholic Federation group. I'd heard of the group, and I knew some other priest friends of mine who had them in their parish, but I never was in a parish that had one. So I got here, and the group, I admit, was dying. It stopped functioning. It was in its the end of its days. But in the early days, it had done an enormous amount to when Catholic immigrants came here from Italy, they would help them get adjusted and blend in and become a part of society and learn what they had to learn in order to function well here, took them out of poverty, educated them well, and it made them feel at home. And the Italian Catholic Federation, I got here and I knew a little bit about it, but I went online and I said, whoa, they gave scholarships and they had clubs and everything to bring the Italians to life in the church and help them exist here well. That's who we are. That's what we've done for this church always, everywhere, all over the world. We've always helped the mission countries. It's what we do. And if you think about it, it comes directly from the Word of God. Did you hear the word today? This isn't rare or new, but Isaiah says it perhaps better than anybody. Let me see if I can pull it up right here real fast. Ah, yes. This is Isaiah speaking for the Lord. He says, thus says the Lord, share your bread with the hungry, shelter the oppressed and the homeless, clothe the naked when you see them, and do not turn your back on your own. That's what he said we should do for others who are in need, God. But this is the reason, or one of the reasons, not just to help them, obviously they need help, but this is what it would do to us, the givers. then your light, the light inside you that led you to do that, to get rid of darkness, then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your wound shall be quickly healed. Your vindication shall go before you. Goes on. If you remove from your midst oppression, false accusation, and malicious speech, if you bestow your bread on the hungry and satisfy the afflicted, then light shall rise for you in the darkness, and the gloom shall become for you like midday. That's what happens to us when we find in ourselves a generous spirit, when we know how to give and to help. In the gospel today, Jesus says it in another way, but just as bold. He says, you're the salt of the earth. What does salt do? It flavors, it preserves. You're the salt of the earth, he said to his followers. And then he says, but what if salt goes flat and loses its taste? Good for nothing. Throw it on the ground and walk on it. He says, you are the light of the world. You are the light of the world. A city set up on a hill, it can't be hidden. Everybody sees it. And like that, who lights a light, a lamp, and then covers up with a bushel basket? Someone who's cuckoo, a cuckoo person. No, you light a lamp and put it up on the lampstand so it gives light to everyone. He says, just so your light must shine before others, that they may see your good works and glorify your Heavenly Father. I think the church, as it grew in this country, and as it affected the lives of so many Catholics, and it provided a home of faith for people to come, to be strengthened and encouraged and feel they belonged. We learned, I was born in 1950, great year, and anyone born around that time, we learned about the corporal and spiritual works of mercy. It was part of that Baltimore Catechism. This is what you do as a Catholic. Especially those corporal works of mercy. They weren't spacey. Feed the hungry. Give drink to those who are thirsty. More people die of lack of water than they do of lack of food in the world. Visit the sick. Visit those in jails. Get out there and do something. And if you do those things, clothe the naked, that doesn't fall out of the sky. It comes out of your pocket. And why do it? Because that's what we do. That's who we are. And it's the only thing that makes sense as followers of Jesus. So in that spirit, about 30 years ago, the cardinal, I was on the priest council at the time, and he came to us and said, I want to begin a group. I'm going to call it Together in Mission. And this group, we're going to collect money from the parishes. We'll have a formula to do it. Everybody will do the same percentage. And this is to help those who are in need, especially the parishes and schools that are going under, that can't make it. I was in one of those parishes in South Central. It was all black and Latino parish. I was one of three white people there. I was in the very, very, very tiny minority. But I had all the power. What can I say? But there I was. And it was a poor entry point for mostly the Latinos. The blacks there were middle class, and they'd been there for years. In fact, they were still there because all the whites moved out after the Watts riots. So they were okay, but they were losing the church they once had there. All the Latinos came in, and it was a poor church, poorest place I ever served in. And I remember one year, before we had this Together Mission, I remember one year I couldn't pay for the salaries for the school. I was so embarrassed. I didn't know what to do. I didn't want to go to the diocese because you'd get this finger, you know, oh, what are you doing? Don't you know what you're doing? You know, like an angry mother, I was, no way. So I wrote a letter to 20 pastors that I knew begging. Said, I can't pay my salaries in the school. Can I one time, only one time this month, ask for your help? Give whatever you can. 11 of them gave me $1,000 apiece. My old ex-pastor, who I don't think he liked me very much, gave me $2,000. Wow. I was surprised, delighted, and felt supported. So the cardinal, understanding that parishes like the one I was in, we were begging all the time, just trying to survive and stay alive. And we have to go to the diocese and beg Monsignor Hawks. Dear God in heaven, what a pain that was to get a little bit of money. So he said, there should be a way that we raise the money every year to help the neediest. These are our brothers and sisters, parishes and schools that can't make it. Let's help them. And that's what he did. He chose this title, Together in Mission, for two reasons. The old way of doing it was go beg from Monsignor Hawks. Go to the archdiocese and beg for the money, and you got it with a lecture and all of that, shaming, and it was ugly. But you got the money. And oftentimes not exactly what you asked for, less, but you got some money. He said, stop that. There should not be a lack of dignity in this. So we need to all do this together, to be together in mission. If everybody gives something, we can reach our goal so easily and be there as a helping hand for parishes and schools that need it. That was his reasoning to call it Together in Mission, that everybody could be included in it. But the idea on a deeper level still, a kind of a theological level, was there is a mission that Jesus has in the gospel. We heard it in the first reading. Feed the hungry. Take care of those who are sick and in prison. Love. Show some compassion, please. Because that's what I do and that's what my followers must do. So as a church, he said, this brands us as believers in this. So today we come here and we do it every year. We do a 10-month pledge, but you might say, Father Perry, what the heck is your problem? We just finished his Renew campaign. But you see, that money comes back to us. The part that goes to the diocese is to take care of seminarians and build seminaries and provide chaplains at the hospitals and at the universities and in the jails. There was at the last Mass a young man who's at UCLA, so I asked him, do you go to the campus ministry there? He says, yeah, it's the Catholic Church services there. And so they pay a chaplain to do that. Who does? The diocese pays the chaplain. There's a bunch of young people, at least five that I know of, that are going to Merced, for the university up in Merced. So I say to all of them, do you go to the chaplains? Because they have a Catholic presence there. And they said, they do. And who pays for those chaplains? The diocese that those universities are in. So we're giving some of this money to the diocese to provide those services that we're not going to go to pay at every jail for somebody. The diocese does it, but we help the diocese do that. But the rest comes back so that we can begin to renovate this place and provide it for the next 100 years and fix it and get it up to date and do what is needed. Realize that every single building was built here before we had the internet. Before we had any connection, everything is out of date. And everything needs upgrading. That's the way it is all over the place. So I'm going to ask you to make sure everyone gets one in the pew. Pass them down. They're on the end. They have a pencil inside. This will take just a minute. I know it's tedious. It's even more tedious for me, let me tell you. Open the flap. Make sure you got one. Everybody in your hand. Hi, did you pass them down? Pass them down. Make sure they get them. Think of it as a delicious piece of chocolate. You just got to have one, okay? You got to have one. And it's real obvious. I'm going to fly through it. It says number 362 St. Bernard Parish because that's our parish. There is another St. Bernard Parish in Bellflower. It ain't going there. It's staying here. I know that's bad English. Forgive me. In that little gray box, it says, my contact information has changed. Mark that especially if since last year when you did this, if you change address or phone number, then it makes them more alert to it, okay? First line, name. Name of the husband, the name of the wife, and the last name. Whoever is filling it out, the spouse's name. Then the second line is your address and your street, or drive, or place, or court, or avenue, and apartment number if you have one. You know, the standard stuff. The third line, city, and zip. If you're out of state and you want to give, well, we'll take it. Thank you. We love you. Fourth line is email. It always helps to have that. And your telephone, either home or mobile or both. And the last line is about credit card. If you want to use that and you want to include a number, any of that information. If you don't have the information, but mark it, they'll contact you and get that out of you. You don't have to put any money in this today. Nothing if you don't want to. But they do ask, what would you pledge? So over on the right, and I found this refreshing. This is a real suggestion. If you give $75 for the year, it's done over 10 months, that's $7.50 a month. $7.50 a month. If you give $100 to this pledge, it's $10 a month over 10 months. Just do something realistic, something that you feel you can do. If you can give more, we'll have to give less. Whatever you do will help. If you write your total pledge there, and if you do put money in, put them out and then subtract it for the balance. If not, just put a zero and you'll get a letter from them. They love to send letters, okay? I can't say this enough. You know, first of all, it really helps if everybody helps. I used to go around and preach this when I was in the poor parish. Pastors would call me. They like to bring speakers in, and they'd bring Father Perry in because he's in the inner city. He's down near Watts, they tell him. So they're thinking, oh, my God, somebody from mission territory. So I went up to La Cunada three times in my years when I was in Mother of Sorrows. And first time I went, I preached all the masses. And I said to Monsignor Wallace, Monsignor, does it take much effort to get this money? It take all 10 months? He says, oh, no, we do it in 2 or 3 weeks. This is the very wealthy parish, 2 or 3 weeks. He said, I get these people come up to me and say, Monsignor, what do you need? Will 30,000 help? Let me just write a check. That's what we have to do for our pledges here, 32,000, I think it is. Somebody to come up and say that. You need, hey, let me give you 30,000. That might help. Of course, they were collecting 800,000 or something for Together in Mission because it was all the same, 10% of the ordinary income from the previous year, and they bring in well over a million. The point is this. This is more than just getting the pledge met. By the way, anything that goes over, again, comes right back to us. But this is about identifying ourselves as a helping hand for others, saying, the Church of Watts, the Church of South Central, you are our brothers and sisters. For God's sake, if you're in need, let us give something. And by the way, they have to raise the same amount, 10% of their previous year's ordinary income. They have to raise it fresh and put it into the pot. So even those that receive, they give the same. I thank you. This is a very important thing that we do in the diocese. And this is something that we do. The bishop doesn't do it for us. We do it. And we do it because we care.